Today, we're going to analyze the performance of the rune effect we created in this video using Niagara's debugging tools. Then, we'll optimize it by migrating it to run on the GPU. And finally, we'll go through what an effect type asset is and how it can be used to cull our effect when it doesn't need to be rendered. Let's get into the action. In our Niagara system, press the performance button in our toolbar. This will toggle the display of the performance costs of our system and emitter modules. Currently, these are very low, as our effect doesn't do much work. For the purpose of teaching, select the blue system node and set the floating particle count to be 2000. As you can see, the average processing time of this particle update stage has gone up quite a lot. But you may be asking, what can you do if you want to have thousands or even millions of particles in your effect? The answer to this can be found in each of our emitters properties. As things stand, all our emitters are processing purely on the CPU. If you wanted to render millions of particles, we would change our simulation target from running on the CPU to running on the GPU. If we do this, we'll also need to enable GPU performance analysis, and this can be done by selecting the drop-down button in the performance options and enabling GPU profiling. As you can see, our particle update stage has gone from taking almost 3 milliseconds on the CPU to taking around 0.2 on the GPU. This is possible as we're using sprite and mesh renderers in our system. You should keep in mind that this isn't always going to work. For example, as things stand in Unreal Engine 5.0, ribbon and light renderers aren't GPU compatible. Another thing to keep in mind is that the emitter stages of our emitters will always get run on the CPU. Another thing that may happen when creating effects in Niagara is that you start off with a template as we did when making our border particles. This template ends up including some modules which you don't end up using. In our case, the solve forces and velocity module is using up 16% of our processing time for this emitter, but we don't actually need it, so let's delete it. Now let's go back to our level editor and open up the Niagara debugger. To do this, go to Tools, then Debug, then select Niagara Debugger. Then go to the Debug panel and enable the Debug HUD and Debug Overview options. This will open up the Niagara Debug HUD in your game, which contains the following headers: the names of our Niagara systems, the number of instances of those systems in our level, the number of scalabilities that our systems have — we'll go into this in more depth in a minute — the total number of emitters in our system, the total number of active particles in our system, and the amount of memory that our system takes up. Let's clone our effect actor. As you can see in the debug HUD, the statistics have changed to include this newly added system. We can also change the debug overview mode to display a performance graph, display GPU compute performance, and show our scalability summary. So what is this scalability? When building a game, you can have a lot of variability in the effect workload depending on how your world is laid out. Sometimes, you may want to take actions to help manage your game's performance, such as culling effect instances outside of a certain range, or instances that exceed a specified CPU or GPU budget. This is where scalability comes in to save the day. These optimizations are implemented via an asset type called effect type, which allows you to configure a variety of settings and then apply them across one or more Niagara systems. To create one of these assets, right-click in your content browser, select Effects, and then Niagara Effect Type. Name this asset NET_RuneOfPower, and then double-click it to open up the asset editor. As you can see here, you have many options available to you. Let's go through them. The Allow Culling for Local Players toggle lets you define whether or not you want this asset's optimization to be applied to effects that are owned by or attached to a local controlled pawn. The Update Frequency attribute lets you define how regularly you want effects of this type to be checked for optimization opportunities. For example, do you want to only check when the effect is being spawned, or do you want to make these checks continuously? Note that this can be quite expensive, so use with caution. The Call Reaction attribute defines how you want the optimization to react to an optimization opportunity. Do you want this effect to be destroyed immediately, being removed from the game world, or do you want it to be put to sleep, letting your particles die naturally and then be re-enabled automatically at a later stage? The Significance Handler attribute lets you optionally define an attribute of your Niagara system to use as a priority handler. For example, are effects further away from the player's camera more important to be optimized than those which are closer? Then we have the System and Emitter Scalability settings. This is where you can set one or more methods to trigger the culling reaction response that you set in the Call Reaction attribute. Let's add an instance to the System Scalability settings array. Each of these instances has 8 attributes that let you set different requirements to trigger the call reaction. If you hover over each of these, you can see a summary of what they do. Let's use an example to demonstrate the power of this system. Back in our Niagara system, select the blue system node and set its effect type to be the one we just created. Then in the level editor, we'll organize the two instances of our effect to be displayed as shown. Now back in our effect type, let's set the update frequency to be continuous. Note that this is expensive and should be used with caution. We'll then set our call reaction to asleep and clear, which will deactivate our effect as soon as it fails to pass the culling test, and then reactivate as soon as it passes this test. Next, we'll set our significance handler to be the distance, and set the maximum system instances to 1. What we're doing here is telling our game that we only ever want to have one instance of this effect active at any point in time, and we want that instance to be the one closest to our player. Back in the level editor, when we move our player from left to right, the effect closest to us gets enabled and the one furthest away gets called. You can also see this information in the debug overview. This scalability suite is very powerful, and its capabilities will continue expanding as Epic releases more UE5 updates. If you have any questions regarding how to use this system, feel free to join the community Discord, where somebody is always around to help. Please like, subscribe, and tell somebody you love them. We'll see you in the next one.